The session on diversifying the global animal justice movement. So if you are in this room for that, thank you. The speakers in this session will be sharing their expertise in different landscapes of the movement, aiming to inform a global audience how they may be able to further support them. The session will touch on the fact that organizations that work in more challenging contexts face the pressing threat of running out of support to continue their work when following global tactics. What should the considerations and expectations so as not to burn out local groups? The session also provides an opportunity to learn about the background that has disconnected people of color from the message of veganism, how the movement empowers these communities, and what others can do to build this community. We definitely want your engagement in this, so if you are versed with the Hoover app, please add questions, ask your questions there. We would appreciate it. So for our first presenter, Vonettia Calloway is committed to empowering children and adults with over 20 years teaching, mentoring, tutoring, and counseling. She holds a BS in liberal arts with minors in behavioral science and biology, along with two master's degrees, with the MAT in secondary education and the other in special education. She began a doctoral program in nutritional healing with the College of Natural Health and Organizational Leadership with Liberty University. She created the Black Vegan Experience as a combined effort, a combined multicultural educational health conference and vegan festival. So please put your hands together for Vonettia Calloway.
If you're close to somebody, to give each other a fist bump or a high five. I am proud of all of you for making the effort to get here and to share our love with the world. Come on, fist bump, high five it. Because I'm a teacher, I wasn't sweating because I was nervous. I was sweating because I ran to Dollar Tree to get gift bags because people do, like, you know how teachers, last minute stuff, right? So I'm racing to get back and get dressed. I didn't put on makeup. I didn't think you cared. And so we're going to have a good time talking about some things that are very important. I've never used a clicker, so disclaimer, if it doesn't click when it's supposed to click, just be patient with me. And, I'm supposed to use the microphone?
Yep.
Oh. Did y'all hear all of that? Do I need to start over? Very good. Who likes free stuff? All right. So I do the Black Vegan Experience. I'm going to talk about that. But what I do is bless people with goodies to encourage them to come and tell other people to come. So I have a beautiful assistant that's going to be passing out some things while I talk. I hope it doesn't distract you. And I'm going to get going. So as a middle school teacher, I had the pleasure of dealing with kiddos all the time. And the first three things I would say in every classroom I went into was, one, I'm vegan. Two, I'm a published author. And three, I'm military. And you know what happens when you say you're vegan? They're like, huh? What? And I would encourage them to share who was vegan in their family or vegetarian if they experienced it, and then I would change the subject so I could just sow a little seed. And I'll talk about that a little later. So the topic, Black people don't know that we're green. Veganism, define. Veganism is a philosophy and way of living which seeks to exclude, as far as it's possible and practicable, all forms of exploitation of and cruelty to animals for food, clothing, or any other purpose, and by extension promotes the development and use of animal-free alternatives for the benefits of animals, humans, and the environment. In dietary terms, it denotes the practice of dispensing with all products derived wholly or partly from animals. I know you guys already knew that. Afroveganism, a little different. Afroveganism is a term that speaks to the experience of being a person of African descent living and interacting in the world as a vegan. It's built on perspectives that are specific to people with both a shared history of race-based oppression and the current experience of racial inequality. The lens provides Afrovegans with an innate understanding of the way oppressive systems operate and a greater desire to reject those systems. Many Afro-vegans have come to view veganism as both a viable solution to some of the challenges that currently face our communities, as well as a vehicle for resisting the systems that are responsible for creating those challenges. So, basically, you're gonna see what's expected, emotional situations, and how to keep things simple. If you never heard of the term BIPOC, BIPOC is referred to, or what we consider, descendants of the enslaved Americans brought into America during the slave trade. It stands for Black Indigenous People of Color. So you're gonna expect to have people that feel some type of way because our history was lost to us. Slavery was not our origin story, but a lot of people who have not befriended those or had time, spent time with other people don't really understand that. People are going to be emotional about things. In a racialized society, each individual's worldwide and lived experiences are constructed within the context of one's identity. Keeping it simple, we're going to view veganism through the unifying lens of diversity and cultural sensitivity. How does a group whose history has been lost learn they come from plant-based ancestry? They learn from other vegans of color in expected and unexpected places, such as events like the Black Vegan Experience, and also research conducted on the history and culture of African people. Origin story, my own. I'm gonna try to keep this as short as I can because I love talking about this. I'm very passionate about it. But I want you to go and explore my pages and our website so you can learn a little about yourself. African vegans also argue that veganism is not a new trend. It simply is a return to traditional African diets. So that's why it's titled Black People Didn't Know They Were Green, because that we came from plant-based ancestry. But again, that was not familiar to us because the history was lost. What a lot of people consider to be the stereotype behind Black communities is soul food. You dust your hog maws, your pork chops, all that stuff, that chitlins, anything that was already disgusting. But that was what was left over, and that's what became part of the tradition, eating those types of food. And that was the standard American diet kind of version of, you know, the cultural food, but that's not what a lot of people really eat. It was the Sunday dinner kind of thing, but we're changing that story because those were high in fat, sugar, all those additives, and we wanted to get rid of that. So big mamas and aunties weren't dying because of genetics, it was because of their diet. So how do you get them out of that mindset? We gotta talk about meat consumption and how it's associated with wealth. You don't have to eat a larger steak because you make more money. Again, mindset. I started with the Daniel fast. We could talk about that a whole another time, but it's basically where you cut out everything that's animal products, including bread, sugar, and alcohol. Very disciplined. So if something sounds like it's common sense, people will ignore it, but if you give them some details, back it up. Tell your own story. Of the 40.6 million people in the United States, there are 6 million Black Americans, but 7.8 billion people in the world. You can see what's gonna happen by 2050. Some examples of how you can share with people. So by the end of me chatting about this, you'll be able to talk about what, who, and why. The vegan lifestyle for the groups of people you connect to, marginalized, underserved, however you want to see these folk that you're gonna be, you know, sharing with, and how they would benefit from veganism as a solution. Again, health disparities plaguing those communities. That's your connecting piece. Mean Africa. Research on the world's healthiest diets, published in Lancet in 2015, revealed that West African countries such as Mali, Chad, Senegal, Sierra Leone, which boasted diets rich in fruits, vegetables, and whole grains, topped the list. Ethiopian cuisine relies on plant-based foods such as the sourdough flatbread injera, lentils, and beans, and many of the country's Orthodox Christians take part in regular fast, hint, hint, during which meals are served without any animal products. Colonization caused a reduction in the farming of indigenous crops. So you can see where these problems started. And you have the tip below that talks about the health issues. Socioeconomic stressors. Environmental pollution, poor health, limited access to health care, name a few. The cost and accessibility of healthy foods versus availability and affordability of fast food in poor neighborhoods circumscribe the dietary choices that result in diets that are high in fat, sugar, sodium, but low in fruits and fiber. In every city, you will see a corner store that sells alcohol and junk food, and grocery stores are 20 to 30 or even an hour away, 30 miles away. So if shared examples aren't sufficient to help you understand connecting those challenges in marginalized communities, reach out and ask for some more examples from their life experiences. That's how you build community. We talk to each other. Nod your head if you agree. Okay, you're with me. So lack of awareness of differing cultural perceptions of illness by the medical community inhibits relations with Black communities. So you're gonna speak to people in various situations, and you're gonna meet them where they are and let them know how that's the solution. It starts with a plate. Understand what they need. Black veganism. This may mean that the center of their veganism is not on animal rights, but perhaps, for example, on the ways eating a plant-based diet is a way to decolonize and fight white supremacy. We are in this work together. A thoughtful consideration. White mainstream veganism can be ineffective in reaching communities of color and sometimes even harmful to other populations. This is why it is imperative to build cross-cultural relationships. You see our friends in this picture? So there are potential barriers for marginalized populations that they face in practicing veganism. So you have to validate those concerns. I hear them all the time, and it's always usually about how expensive food is, but that's a lie. You have to just do some research. From health to education, except for the bougie junk food, y'all know that. So from health to education, since the beginning of the new century, health disparities between the races continue to grow. Without regard for advanced medical research and technology in the United States. When compared to other Black Americans who have other groups, Black Americans have shortest life expectancies and the highest rate of mortality. Cardiovascular disease is the leading cause of death, and diabetes and cancer are also prevalent. So it shows you about the studies of Black immigrants and how they had better health coming into the United States than the Black Americans that were here as, you know, the indigenous populations. Something's going on, right? Some examples of how we can relate and compare. People need to understand how your vegan journey started too. So you choose your why when you're going out and you're bridging these gaps between communities. I always say, go across the street, meet your neighbor, find out what they like to do, find out what they like to eat. You can bribe people if you take them out to lunch. They won't know, right? If you treat people to eat and you don't tell them what restaurant you're going to, I guarantee you'll get some smiles and they still will appreciate you guys. So, deliver data with the context of a story that you've already told. You don't have to make anything up, just share from your heart. I think that's very important, just being authentic. Making big numbers digestible by putting them in the context of something familiar. We don't want people to feel like, one, feel intimidated or that you're trying to talk down to them, even though you're just trying to share information. Just connect it, make it relatable. Use pictures, be kind, be patient. There are different types of reasons that people go vegan. We have to remember that. And I know we're going hard for the animals, but again, we want to remember that there are some that go in for the environment, for personal health, and animal rights. That talks about data. So, this is a pretty picture, isn't it? More than 12 million Africans were shipped to the New World. Shows you the numbers, 338,000. And all of this, these resources will be at the end for those who are people like me who want to go check, fact check, and they arrived in North America. So this is something that I feel like is like really important in how we connect these dots. It's interesting, the interesting thing about colonialism is that it often leaves its trace behind in a culture that it dominated. Those traits become associated with the colonized culture, while the former colonizers move towards a way of life that is more similar to that of the people they colonize. The sad aspect of this cycle is that the colonized cultures then adopt what was bad about the colonizers' culture and have to be retaught their own culture by the dominant one. Case in point, vegetarianism, veganism. Our descendants came from that culture, but it was lost to them. So we just have to make sure we're reteaching and taking our time to get to know people. And that's the same thing on the bottom that was said before, using pictures, making it digestible for the communities that you're reaching out to. And closing. I know y'all like this part. Build confidence around your vegan outreach, connecting to other cultures. Share your milestones, what has been accomplished and what might be left to tackle. Find the same thing with them. Testimonials. You have some friends who are going to talk the people's ears off and just keep them excited. Find those folk. Get some testimonials. Record it. Get some short ones, too, because you don't want to lose people. The mind can only endure as much as the hiney can, right? So when your booty starts to get tired, your brain has stopped working, right? I knew you knew. That's why. Listen. So what's next? How can you get more involved and find out more? Connect. Black Vegan Experience, Afro-Veg Society. There are so many more out there, but just wanted to let you guys see a little bit more. Call me. I love vegan outreach. All you got to do is feed me. How people are influenced. Social media, those are your influencers, your media personalities. Music, it moves them like magic. Relationships. And I posted a video on the Hoover app of my nephew who called me this morning and shared something new with me, and it was absolutely adorable. I didn't know if it related. I didn't think you would mind. He's 6 years old. He watched his first Farm to Fridge video 3 weeks ago, and now he is empowering me all over again. So stinking cute. All right, so in case you don't know anything about hip-hop, the hip-hop nation is where a lot of black celebrities, influencers, were already using, not using like animal products, going vegan. And so it has its place with its own language, culture, and history, and represents community. So you tap into that. I don't really like all of it, but you can find some people, you can get some music on, and you can connect to folk and share. Reach your audience with what resonates with them and inspire them to act on the information they learn. Keep it simple. We can do this, right? Right? That's right. So, hope you will use these tips to go out and create an inclusive vegan community. Now, because I'm a teacher, what do teachers usually give you after class or you learn something? A quiz? I knew you knew it. Can you pull up the quiz for this beautiful group of learners? And I have prizes. I know your teachers did not give you presents in school for learning, but Ms. Calloway loves to bribe people to do their best. So if you will kindly put this code in, you'll go to Book It, or you can scan the QR code, which is new. They didn't have this when I was in the classroom, I swear. Look, they thought they were gonna get out of this, y'all. It's only 5 minutes. There's a lot of questions, but because you all are not middle schoolers and you're familiar with most of the movement, I felt like you could kind of get as much done as possible in 5 minutes. And once we have enough people joining, we're gonna start and we're gonna go out and change the world together. Ooh, look at, where's the music? Aww. Y'all, it's so fun. Let's see. Oh, I see him popping up there. Okay. Oh, right? That's cool, right? Show of hands who's still trying to get in. We got 30 seconds. Come on, faster. Y'all clap for them as they get logged in. This is hard for some people. No clapping. No. Okay. There it is. Yes. All right. 10, 9, 8, 7, 6, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1, start. You can skip that part. They don't need to know the rules. They're smart. So guys, my time was over 2 minutes ago. But you can keep playing the game without me falling off stage. You can keep playing the game so I can let my colleague continue and we'll turn off the sound and I'll still see all of your answers and who you did the best and give out the gifts a little later. So thank you so much for listening and for playing and hope to see you around in the halls.
Vonettia Calloway, and I've attended the Black Vegan Experience, and it is definitely an amazing experience, so make sure you follow Black Vegan Experience. Our next guest, Kaho, was born and raised in Japan, currently based in Ontario, Canada, as a program coordinator at Animal Alliance Asia. She leads in designing the programs executed in 10 different Asian countries and other projects such as research and conferences. With her experiences in social and environmental justice organizing and her academic background in sociology, she brings intersectional perspectives and anti-oppressive approach to the animal justice movement. Give it up for Kaho Nishibu.
Okay, this is very overwhelming. I've never been this many, like, in front of this many audience, so I'm sorry if I messes up my talk, but thank you everyone for coming to this session. And yeah, thank you for organizers for organizing this summit. I hope everyone's having a wonderful time. Thank you for our panel and Nigel for facilitating this session as well. So hi everyone, my name is Kaho and I'm a program coordinator at Animal Alliance Asia. And today I'll be talking about how we can make our space more inclusive and equitable. So I think some of you might not have heard of Animal Alliance Asia, so I just want to start with just briefly explaining what we do, who we are. So Animal Alliance Asia was founded by two Asian women, Angel and Ellie, in 2019. So we're still a young organization, but we're slowly finding our ways to build a more culturally appropriate, inclusive, and more effective animal justice movement in Asia. And we, to do that, we provide support and resources to local individual animal advocates and some organizations across Asia, and we also try to build coalition among them as well. And we currently operate in 11 different countries in East, Southeast, and South Asian regions. One of them is inactive at the moment because of the military coup in Myanmar. So 10 of them are active. And we have a country coordinator in each country who does the groundwork, who has a direct connection with the local advocates, and they provide support to those groups. And at this point, we're not planning to expand into different regions for many reasons, but one of them being that there are other organizations who have more expertise in those regions that are doing the work already. So for example, the Middle East Vegan Society or China Vegan Society, they're doing a wonderful job. So if you haven't checked them already, please do so. And we're just sticking with the 10 countries for now. So why do we do capacity building work in Asia? So in the fall and winter of 2022, we conducted our forums in 10 different countries to really understand the current landscape of the animal justice movement in that country and the challenges and opportunities that in that movement. And each country had its own unique challenges, and we can't generalize our findings, but to give you kind of a general trends that we saw from our findings, there are currently very few organizations solely focused on farmed animal advocacy, even though 75% of the world farmed animals live in Asia. So there's a gap there. And we also found that there's a lack of financial resources, advocacy training, and country-specific information and knowledge. And when we talk about country-specific information and knowledge, we're not only talking about information about the status of animal exploitation and abuse, but also about what works effectively in that country. So information about different approaches, culturally appropriate approaches. And another interesting finding was that even though there are lots of international support going into Asia, sometimes such support can constrain the way people and organizations work in Asia. And there is a full report available online, so if you're interested, please check it out. And informed by those findings, we now focus on kind of four main goals. And the first one being to kind of bring more people into the movement through our programs and build stronger local leadership. So we do projects like regranting projects in academy, and hopefully that would lead to more kind of strengthening the local network of people. And we also do research and forums. And through those programs, we kind of identify what works effectively in that country. And we also kind of have those programs as a way to build communities. And I really love that Vonettia touched on community, like importance of having a community a lot. And I think even within the advocacy group, it's really important to have like a really safe space for the advocates to come together and so we can kind of sustain the movement. And so the big question we have today for this session is, how can we diversify the animal justice movement? And hopefully we know by this at this point that diverse perspectives and experiences can help the movement to grow. You know, we always talk about movement as ecology or ecosystem, and you know, it's really important to have different diverse people for the movement to grow. So the good news is the movement is already diverse. However, not everyone has the same equal opportunities to perform their maximum potentials due to various different kinds of barriers that they face. So for example, this is the picture of one of our forums in Pakistan. And our country coordinator in Pakistan was telling me how in this particular region that they had this event at, it's less socially accepted for women to go outside by themselves and go to this kind of educational event. So our country coordinator had to actually kind of work them individually to their home to make sure that they get home safely. So those are kind of the barriers that we don't often think about that people face in different regions in Asia. So then we need to ask ourselves, how can we make our space more inclusive and equitable so that everyone, and especially historically and currently marginalized people's voices are heard and they're at the table and they're taken seriously? So I would like to hear from the audience, maybe a few people can shout. What do you think some of the barriers for people in Asia to participate in animal justice movement? Anyone? Freedom of speech? Great one. Security, is it? Yes, security. So like a lot of political issues. Anyone else? Cultural expectation, great, thank you so much. Oh, sorry.
Gender inequalities,
yeah, thank you so much. I think I have some of them on the slide as well. So the political issues could be like repression of activists or war or conflicts that can be a major barriers. And those are not specific to Asia, but they are the realities for many people in Asia. And as someone said, social expectations or gender inequality, social hierarchies, and you know the thing that I just mentioned about Pakistan, those can be a barrier as well. And language is also one, and especially when we look at the global animal justice movement, we just kind of take it for granted that English is by default, you know, it's the default language. And not everyone can speak English, obviously, and I'm not saying that we should start Mandarin or we should start learning Thai or anything like that, but I think it's important that we acknowledge that that can be a barrier for some people. And also, I think I wanted to really highlight the fact that just because someone can't speak English doesn't mean that they don't know anything. So that's really, I would really you know, just highlight that point. And in just speaking of language, we can also think of like language in terms of what kind of like language are we just using, professional language? Are we using a lot of jargons? And those can be also a problem. And you know, when we're in the West and we use all these terms, but then those terms, we might be familiar with them, but not necessarily for people in Asia. So those are things that we can be aware of. And another thing, the big thing is technological inequalities. And I'm not saying that that doesn't exist in North America, but particularly in Asia, in different region, of many regions actually, there people don't have stable access to internet. So that can be also a barrier as well. And there are lots more. So I encourage everyone to start thinking about different kinds of barriers if you work with other people or people from other countries or communities. And so just to kind of identify those barriers and trying to break down those barriers, we try to take a bottom-up approach. So these are the kind of the things that we do, but I hope that you can maybe take some of them home as well. So the first one is to acknowledge that the local advocates are the experts. I think it's really important to for us to dismantle this idea of, you know, or dismantle the kind of, or challenge the saviorist mentality that we have. I'm not gonna say we, maybe like some of the, I think people in the West usually have, and not everyone, some of them have, and I think we should challenge that and really understand that the local people know their needs, know their strategies. So I really hope that we can, everyone can, we can listen to them and not to impose, you know, what's effective in their country. And we also have to be aware of power dynamics. Sorry, just going back to the first point, I just wanted to say thank you to Phonalytics and the Good Girls. I don't know if you were here, but they're helping us. They're helping us study the kind of the needs, the strategies of the local advocates through research. So thank you so much. And the second point, we should be also aware of power dynamics. Just because someone's at the table doesn't mean that they have the equal opportunity to participation. Diversity without inclusivity and equity is tokenization. So let's be aware of our power dynamics in terms of race, gender, sexuality, disability, age, and so on. And the third one, we should also avoid assumptions and generalization. So just because one person says so doesn't mean the whole group think the same. And lastly, build rapport and establish mutually beneficial relationships. I think this takes a long time, and this takes time and effort, but this is such an integral part of doing the work with local advocates, especially if you're coming from outside of that community. And to end my presentation, I also wanted to talk about our organizational culture. This is my beautiful team. We're all from different backgrounds, culture, religion, language, other socioeconomic backgrounds. And so we have a range of experiences and perspectives within the organization. And I wanted to talk about this because it's not always easy to work within such a multicultural environment. I think it's important to recognize that diversity can also create conflicts. But there are ways to avoid, mitigate, and resolve such conflicts. So in our team, we provide resources like multicultural and system awareness training, safer space policies, mental health resources, and we also ask our team constant feedback so that we can try to make our space more inclusive and equitable. And I think it's also, it's important because ultimately how we work within the organization translates to how we work with others outside of the organization. So this is not to say that, you know, our organization is perfect, but I really encourage everyone to look internally and ask, like, who is holding power, who is being listened to, who is less hard, those kind of tough questions to make your work space really inclusive and accessible and equitable so that you can do the same, you can do the same outside of your organization as well. So just to take away points, I encourage everyone to start thinking about those different barriers that I mentioned earlier and kind of thinking of if you can do something about that. So it could be like, you know, providing different language options for your programs. If you have in-person events, you can do maybe, you can choose wheelchair accessible venues or something like that. And if you can do that, find someone who can do that, who is doing that already. If you think of something, there's a chance that someone else are thinking about same thing already. So it's good to do some research and try to collaborate with others as well. So that concludes my presentation. Thank you everyone so much.
Give it up for Kaho Nishibu. Thank you so much. All right, our next guest is Anna Ortega. Anna Ortega oversees all aspects of the Humane League México, an independently incorporated Mexican charity, including corporate outreach, strategic campaigns, and movement building. Anna has been with the Humane League for 8 years and leads efforts to secure cage-free policies from the largest corporations in Mexico and Latam. Please give it up for Anna Ortega.
Hi everyone, I'm Anna. I'm Anna Ortega. Yeah, I'm gonna deal with this. This is my first time also with clicker, so be patient. So I'm gonna introduce myself a little bit. So I live in La Paz, Mexico, in Baja California Sur. I am the coolest aunt, according to my two nieces. This is very kind of biased, of course. I also the companion human of one human and two doggies. I'm the personal assistant of one fluffy cat. And also, I'm a free diver. I'm a scuba diver. I love to be in the ocean, and this has been my therapy to be on check with my mental health. And also because I love to have my head smashed in the water, I'm trying to learn how to kiteboard, and I'm just going crazy on CrossFit since November because I love to be a strong woman. So I want to talk to you about the importance of global local context in global strategies, and I want to introduce you to this concept of curiosity. And the reason that I want to share these ideas is because I know that in animal rights movement, we want things to move really fast. And we created these global strategies, and we need to be aligned, and we need to be connected among all the groups, and we need to be very damn brave to do this. And of course, every region has its own context, and each context has its own challenges, and they can slow down or they can make things move faster in the global strategies. And in every region that we can work in for animal rights, we need curiosity, and I'm going to tell you why. So having curiosity for the context of others enhances our understanding and effectiveness of the animal rights movement. It creates, helps us to create empathy and perspective. It improves our communication, and I love this part because you just have to learn how to be present and also how to listen to others, like actively listen. Instead of thinking what you are gonna answer when the other person is talking, you need actually to be present and to be actively there for them. And all this is going to help us to build trust and collaboration among all the groups. And the other favorite part that I is my experience on this is that helps your personal growth. Because let's be honest, like having all this type of events puts together so many people who are like so intelligent, so smart, and it's just, they're just there. We just need to be more curious. So to illustrate much better about how not to be curious, I'm gonna tell you a story about missing the context on global strategies. And I'm gonna share you my personal story working with groups outside Mexico. And specifically, I want to talk about ARBA in Peru. I'm gonna share with you my story about Iselda Liboni, which is a wonderful and smart woman who is leading this organization in Peru. So I had the pleasure to meet Iselda in 2017 while she applied to be part of the Open Wing Alliance, which is part of the coalition that was created by the Human League. And I had the pleasure to go and meet her and also to train her in Peru for the corporate relations work. And so eventually I went there and I basically, because I didn't hear to her, I wasn't observing, I wasn't being empathetic, I forced the idea of implementing a Mexican version of Bad Cop in Peru. So imagine how it went. So looking back at that point, I can laugh right now of my mistake, but back then, for sure, I was not paying attention to the difference among the two cultures, the Peruvian and Mexican cultures. And so in Mexico, for example, we are kind of afraid of saying no. So at that moment, it helped us very well to my colleague, Jenny Haynes, who is also in this picture. And so we could go in meetings who were not scheduled. And we just it was super fun to get into these buildings that were super highly secure and just getting meetings without any notification before. And so we tried to do the same thing in Peru, and you can imagine how it went. So actually, this is a picture before the meeting. We were so smiling, but now I don't have the after that picture. So I remember very clearly when the receptionist just just look at us, look at me, like no lady, you're not gonna come here. And we have to leave very, with my ego in the floor. And since then, curiosity takes time. So you need time to be, to listen and to be open to the others. And I made a big mistake because I wasn't curious enough. I wasn't asking Iselda, what could work in this environment? You know the context better than I. And but Iselda, as a wise and smart woman that she is, she got immediately the idea of the goal of the Open Wing Alliance. And then even though I gave her a manual of how to do corporate relations in the Mexican way, she could understand not also the goal, but she knew very well herself, and she knew what were her strengths and what was her context. So since then, ARBA has, and we have someone from ARBA here, so she has grown from 2 people to 12, and since then, they have been the good cop for excellence, and they have secured more than 50 cage-free commitments, and now they have an open dialogue with more than 300 businesses. Also, they have been working with egg producers, so they have been collaborating with them, being, again, the good cop, and teaching them how to go cage-free. And not to mention that only to mention 12 undercover investigations covering not only layer hens, but pigs, horses, and guinea pigs. And also they have this big achievement that they, of getting one district cage-free in their country. So Iselda and her team's results are beyond impressive. Also because talking about context, We need to consider that in Peru, in the last 3 years, they have had 6 different presidents. So this has created a lot of social chaos. And Peru also has been, it's a country where 22% of the population is poor, and 40% of the transactions of especially, 40% of the transactions are informal. This means that the tractability of the eggs is mostly impossible, as in many LATAM countries. And on top of that, the information of corporations, of businesses are very, and general statistics of anything about agriculture is very hard to find. So in the animal rights movement, we always say that we're going to go fast, we need immediate results, and we also say we are not in a sprint, but it's an endurance race. And the truth is that if we want to change the situation of the animals in the world, we need to slow our approach, and depending on the context of each region, and trust the process of each leader. So why do we need curiosity? It's because of the global scale that we want to work for the animals. Being curious about others gives us the gift to better understand and connect and enhance our global strategies. And if you are coordinating groups around the world, like if you work in different regions, also if you give funds and you are foreseeing the work of all these groups around the world, so please, consider to be open, to listen, and also please support ARVA. And most importantly, I want to recognize the work of all women in this movement and the importance of elevating and supporting each other. Thank you.
That's okay. Give it up for Anna Ortega. This is what diversity looks like in the global movement. You got African American, Asian American, Mexican American, and Afro-Latina American. Okay, now time for questions. We have some questions. When you think of diversity, and this is for everyone on the panel, what or who do you see?
I see all of us. This room is diverse. We just need to continue to grow it.
Yeah, I mean, I touched on it in my presentation that, you know, the movement is already diverse, but sometimes we might be missing some voices, experiences, and perspectives because of different kinds of barriers. So even though it might look diverse enough, but then we can be more diverse. So I think it's probably good to, you know, try to improve ourselves and include more people.
Well, I think it depends always on context. And also, I think that, as I mentioned, like we need to be curious. And I think that everybody can participate in their own way.
Thank you for that. How is Afro-veganism similar or different to what AF and Silco call Black veganism? I guess everyone could take a stab, but I think Vonettia, the Black vegan experience.
I mean, I believe that Afro-veganism is synonymous with Black veganism. Is that, you know, sometimes when we use Afro, then it, you know, you're connecting Afro-Latinas, which in my mind, it connected already because we have those that come from both that reflect all. But to answer the question, I believe it's the same, right?
I believe it's the same, too. I mean, I don't know if I introduced myself earlier when we were here, but I'm Nadja Wright Brown, Executive Director of Black Fed Society. And when you think of the Black, yeah, it's Afro, it's Black, it's Asian, it's Mexican, Puerto Rican, all of that in one. So thank you for that. The next question we have here is the biggest demographic in the Latin community in the U.S. is the Mexican-American community. It is over 50%. Why is it that most Latin campaigns in the U.S. are really not focused on this demographic?
Well, maybe you should ask to the people who is running these campaigns in the US. Yeah. Well, I think that that's part of the of so many problems. Not problems, but the challenges of like who is included on this type of decisions. And I understand that, like timing is really important, but also that this representation that we urge to have is happening right now, and we're building this like as we speak right now.
Thank you for that. For everyone, this question is open to you. How well are we doing in regards to including people with various disabilities?
Well, I would say none of you probably knew that I have invisible disabilities. And just how the organization has presented the information that's shared, I feel that they're being intentional on making sure people feel welcome. And they need our feedback. I think that's important. So if you don't see something that should be done to make sure people feel included who are differently able, then to speak up and speak truth and love. You don't have to be mean about it.
I think when we talk about disability, we can think of physical and mental disabilities. So yeah, there are lots of aspects that we can think of. And in terms of, I think, being accessible in terms of visually and audio or wheelchair accessibilities, I think some in-person events, as far as I see, are I think trying to be better, but we could be better. In terms of like, mental disabilities, I know that within our team there are many neurodivergent people, and you know they have been really marginalized like from the group in the previous workplace. So we're trying not to replicate that kind of experiences for them and really listen to them. And yeah, like as I said earlier, diversity can create conflicts, and like oftentimes like neurodiversity can create different work conflicts in terms of work styles or preferences. But I think just understanding where they come from, understanding, being flexible and adaptable to different situations is probably the one thing that we can do. So, yes.
Well, I think that we are just starting to understand like the challenges. I can speak from, especially from Mexico, I think that we are still like figuring out like what does, how can we include people with various disabilities. And even though we try to comply on what the law says, like we understand that we are so behind. So I think we are trailblazers as organizations, like in a trial and error type of experience right now.
Thank you for that. Well, this is, a question that if anyone knows can answer. How does activism look in authoritarian states or countries with limited freedom of speech and assembly? Woo.
I mean, a lot of Asian countries have, experiencing the rise of authoritarian states. And for some people, they can't even post about animal rights on their social media. They would be, you know, censored or banned and targeted at the worst case. So when we do approach the local advocates, we try to be careful with not putting the local advocates at unnecessary risk of being targeted by the state. And so for in our program, for example, we did a workshop on security, like digital security. So that's kind of one of the things that we were trying to do at the same time. But it's a really tricky situation, and like there's so much that like the movement can do, and that kind of context, I think, yeah, just kind of being more careful with our messages is one of the things that I think we can do.
Thank you. Anyone else speak?
Well, we have to deal, for example, we need to choose our campaigns depending on like the companies that we target. If we know that they're related to narco trafficking, that is a big no. So it's the kind of safe enough that we need to comply with our volunteers. Also, in the protests, also we have to be careful because sometimes police can be very harsh with us. So yeah, that's a big challenge. So
thank you for that. We have two more questions, and then I can take some from the audience if we have the time. How can organizations and activists address power dynamics in their communities or interpersonal relationships to ensure safer spaces for new and vulnerable activists?
I share on the platform when we're promoting events and at the event through our hostess or myself on stage that it is a safe place if anyone has been made to feel uncomfortable about what they're sharing. That's why we have security. And if you are making people feel that they cannot share, speaking their truth in love, then that's our job as the organizer to make sure that we handle that. I just feel like when you're reassured that you feel comfortable sharing the information that is needed, and there's a way to do that and keep people protected.
Yeah, I agree with you completely. And just to add on to that, I think self-reflection is one of the most important things that we can do as an organizer. And sometimes I was talking to a Japanese feminist the other day and talking about privilege, and we're saying that privilege is something that we don't have to think about. So unless we kind of start thinking about it seriously, it might not be aware that we hold some sort of power. So I think just kind of doing that self-reflective work, I think is probably important.
Okay, thank you. And the last question we have in the HUVA is, what are examples of mental health resources that Animal Alliance Asia provides for its members that other AR organizations can replicate?
We have this thing called personal user manual. I'm aware that other organizations have things like that also. And we use that as a way of kind of being transparent about our strengths, weaknesses, if we have any disabilities or any backgrounds of, like clinical conditions that we should be aware of as a coworker. So that's something that we do. And we encourage everyone to fill in that form so that, you know, we don't have to learn that as we work together. We know that like upfront. So, you know, like if we have an understanding of, have a weakness in this point, then maybe I can support that. It's all about just coming back to the point of diversity. You know, we have different strengths and weaknesses, and I think that kind of difference is, we always say that our difference make us stronger. So I think, just kind of being transparent about it if people are comfortable.
Oh, go ahead. You want to say something? Are you good? You're right. Okay. Is there anyone that has any questions in the audience? Are we good? Okay, yes. Did you hear that?
Yeah, that's a really difficult question. And I think we still have this kind of colonial imperialist mindset in the West. And I just have one correction. I know you introduced me as Asian American, but I'm actually Asian. I'm not. I'm an immigrant in Canada, which is okay. I didn't tell you that, so that's okay. So my experiences are different from Asian Americans, so I just wanted to make that clear. And I think being in Asia, I think it's really difficult because we also have that inferiority complex type of mentality. Like we look up to white people, so we also have a work to do. And just kind of having this conversation with other areas of social justice movement might be also helpful as well, because, you know, there are other kind of causes that the people in the West look at as like your, you know, like behind or not progressed or something like that. So yeah, just like I think learning from other social justice movements might be helpful.
Thank you for that.
Who wants to take that?
You asked a couple of different things, and I'll just address as much as I can remember. So when I see and think about diversity, I want to see all nations represented. And I don't feel that all nations feel that they're welcome at events because they're not necessarily vegan or vegetarian yet. My advocacy, my message begins with my family. As I was just saying, I have a little six-year-old nephew that is connecting to veganism because of me sharing food with him in a video. So until you can relate and connect to diverse groups, we will never get more diversity involved. You can have people that align with some of it, but because of their history with other groups, they're not going to connect unless you can find a way to bridge the divides. And that means building relationship.
No, we're good. Is that good?
That's a good answer, like building relationships. You know?
That's where it starts. Yes. That's where it starts. So I mean, we can have a whole big conversation about that because I love talking about that. Build the relationships first. Any other questions? The religions? What are the religions?
I was going to say, can you defy foodism?
Buddhism.
Oh, Buddhism.
Yeah.
I'm out.
The religion centrified. You want to repeat that again?
Yeah, what is the role of like vegetarian, non-Western religions, such as Buddhism, in the animal rights movement in Asia?
Yeah, so this is also a difficult question. Just because someone's Buddhist and coming from Buddhist country doesn't mean that they practice vegetarianism. Like a lot of people who are coming from Buddhist countries actually eat meat. What was I going to say? And I think when it comes to, we can definitely use that as an advantage to, you know, have more awareness around veganism, vegetarianism. But at the same time, those things, that kind of approach are often kind of associated with the health argument, which is still effective and useful. But then there we kind of sometimes lose sight of the ethical arguments as well. So there's like a different kind of tricky balance of using that approach. I don't know if I answered your question.
Thank you.
All right, we have 4 more minutes. Any other questions? Oh, right here, Jasmine. I love that.
I personally felt that the animal advocacy was disconnected from the Black vegan experience because most of my brothers and sisters who I needed to come and participate were afraid of building a relationship with me to understand what we were doing to have it represented. So I was very excited to have PETA Kids and the Humane League participate because, again, that's not why I connected to veganism. My journey began with my health. So I have to have those that are experiencing that. That's their niche. You connected for the animals to speak from your experiences. So, again, I love it. I have them there. But we got to continue to do the work. Find out the whys and get connected.
I have a lot of, I think, learnings from just being involved in the movement, but I think one thing that I want to share is probably just to be humble about what you know, and especially working with different people in Asian countries. And I'm educated in a Western context, so I do have a kind of a sense of, like, I know these things, but then sometimes, like, when I talk to my colleagues or local advocates, those kind of ideas are challenged. And it's really eye-opening because there are something that we can't learn from, like, Western education. And there is some knowledge that you can only get from, like, working on the ground. So I think just being humble about what you know is, like, probably one of the great learnings for me.
Okay, one of my best memories about joining this movement is how I joined it. So I think it was like 15 years ago, where I was advocating for dogs and cats. And I went to a conference in my college, and I got stuck in the middle of a PETA presentation. And then I saw this video of Meet Your Meat. And then I became a vegetarian. And then that time it was Bruce Frisch who was the leading this conference, and he introduced me to Peter Singer. So actually I went to the airport to pick up Peter Singer, and that's how I read Animal Liberation. And as magical as my life could be, he inspired me so much that I started a PhD. And when he saw, he knew that I was accepted for doing this PhD, he invited me to Princeton. So I went to Princeton to classes with him, which is also awesome, and has been my most, like, I know, impactful experience I ever had, because as a Mexican woman in a middle age, it was kind of difficult to see yourself, like, being invited, you know, to this type of universities. And so yeah, I got so super inspired by this experience, and that's how I feel that when you follow your heart and you feel this inspiration, you just can't let you go and be there.
Thank you again, everyone, for the questions. Give it up one more time, Vonettia, Kahu, and please connect with Vonettia about the treats, because I'm about to dig in those bags and give it away. Okay, we'll do that after the session. I'm not gonna give it away. So thank you again. Vonettia has treats. If you want to come up and get them, please do so at this time.